The views and opinions expressed on this program are those of the participants and do not reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
BronxNet. Your voice, your views, your vision.
Welcome to Bronx Talk. On Wednesday of this week, Governor Andrew Cuomo will be delivering his State of the State address, which many speculate will have a progressive-leaning tone to it. Of course, New York City has a new mayor, Bill de Blasio, who many expect will set a so-called progressive agenda for the city. So where are we headed? Has been our practice for more than 19 years. We bring you closer to your elected officials who will weigh in on these and other topics tonight. If you'd like to join the discussion or ask questions, please call in at 718-960-7241 or email questions or comments to us at bronxtalk@hotmail.com, and we'll read those on the air during a future edition of our program. But for the here and now, welcome to the state senator from the 31st Senatorial District, which is on the west side of Manhattan in a tiny sliver of the Bronx, Senator Adriano Espaillat. Thank you for joining
us. Thank you so much for inviting me.
And from the 81st Assembly District in the North Bronx, it's welcome back to Assemblyman Jeff Dinowitz. Thank you, sir, for joining us.
Good to be here as usual.
Assemblyman, let's start with you, and we'll ask your colleague here the same question. So the latest catchword in New York politics is progressive. It's been said that now New York has a progressive mayor that will start a shift throughout the nation. Before we get to the nation, what about New York State? Will Governor Cuomo unleash a progressive-oriented agenda? Is that your anticipation for the State of the State on Wednesday?
I've never heard a word so overused as the word progressive this year.
Oh, I'm sorry. I've overused it already tonight.
Let's call it liberal, because that's what it is, and why mince words? I'm hoping that that's exactly what will happen. I'm hoping the governor talks about the issues which clearly people in New York City voted on this year, fixing our schools, among other things, jobs, the very issues which got Bill de Blasio elected, I think are issues that people, for the most part, throughout the state agree with. New York City may be a liberal bastion, but I think most people in this state want universal pre-K, for example, which was at the heart of the de Blasio campaign. And that may or may not be something the governor talks about Wednesday, but it's certainly something that we're going to be working on this year, and hopefully the governor will as well.
Do you think that the mood, I guess it will be different in the Assembly than maybe the Senate, and we'll get to the senator about that, that the mood is encouraging, that they're saying, you know what, this is a shift we like? And again, do you think the governor, even aside from being politically savvy, is in tune to it?
The governor is very politically savvy. I believe he wants to do the right things. And, you know, the Assembly has passed, over the years, repeatedly the, quote, progressive agenda.
So you're blaming him, is that?
No, I'm not blaming him.
Yeah. The other guys.
He's one of the good guys there. But when you talk about a universal pre-K, that was a program that originated in the state assembly, the so-called ladder program, which we started in 1997. The 10 points women's equality agenda, that's legislation that we passed in the assembly. And there's a whole list of things. So if we want to have a progressive agenda throughout New York, all that has to happen is everybody has to do what the Assembly's already done.
What do you think? What's going on in the Senate?
You know, somebody put it best. I read an article in the paper where somebody called the atmosphere in this city, right, a civic renaissance. And I think that is fueled primarily by income inequality. The fact that the middle class is disappearing, is hurting, that poor people and working class people are making minimum wage at $7.25. that there's this widening gap between the very rich and the very poor and the working class and the middle class, and people are really fed up. So it got de Blasio elected. I think that the governor has touched on it. It polls very well. For example, the increase of the minimum wage had a big approval rate across the state. Taxing the rich has a 70% approval rate across the state of New York. So these are very popular issues that are right at the core of what has just occurred in New York City. And this is an election, a re-election year in the state legislature. And I'm sure that many will be looking at this issue, income inequality, as a driving force.
Well, today the mayor began the direct appeal to the state legislature to say, okay, now let's look at the tax code. But the feeling has been, you know what, maybe this taxing the rich as far as their income tax is not the way to go. Is there a compromise position such as reinstitute the commuter tax or do something else to pay for universal?
Well, you know, the mayor clearly stated that he wanted the tax increase. What they're advocating for, and I'm in agreement with, is a home rule message, meaning that if upstate is not with it, that if other regions of the state are not supporting that, that perhaps the legislature can give a home rule just for New York City, where there is a very high approval rate for this measure, so that we can implement this tax and generate the revenue for the universal pre-K program that the assembly member touted just a few minutes ago.
In the much more divided Senate, do you see that kind of a thing as something that would play? Because so many of the upstate Republicans are going to say, you know what, we don't want to touch this, we don't like the idea, so let us do what we want, and you liberals in New York can do what you want.
Well, you know, I heard Senator Klein speak about it. You know, Senator Klein was receptive to the mayor's proposal. I'm not sure if the Republicans on the other side of the aisle will embrace it, but I think that there is enough Democrats and a few independent Democrats, whereas if we come together, we'll have the votes to pass this measure. There's no reason why we should not do it. At the very least, do the home rule piece of it to allow the New York City to get the revenues necessary to implement universal pre-K and after-school programs for intermediate schools.
The Independent Democratic Caucus, which you have just referred to, does this help or hurt the possibility of a so-called progressive agenda or moving things forward? Are you a fan of this? Do you feel that this is useful? Because you've already alluded to it.
I would like to see them support more of the issues that the traditional Democratic Conference has sponsored. You know, I think that this year we may see that. We may see them come a little bit to our side, a little bit more often to our side. And the governor understands this. I think the governor could appeal to us in the Democratic Conference and the Independent Democratic Coalition to get the votes lined up for important issues that are progressive, as you said at the beginning of the program, that are very important to most New Yorkers. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking forward to that.
Assemblyman, I know you probably, or I shouldn't say I know, but I'm guessing you probably don't like the idea that if you're a liberal or you're progressive, that automatically means you want to spend money. Now, we've already talked about programs that you want to see in place. You know, it's almost like the pendulum swings the other way. Now, all of a sudden, the liberals take over Albany, and all of a sudden, well, now we're going to spend, and guess what? There's no way to spend. There's no way to put in universal pre-K programs without paying for it. There's no way to improve affordable housing without paying for it. Is there a way to get this agenda across without bloating the budget beyond comprehension, and now, all of a sudden, in April, you have a problem passing a budget?
Well, first, let's be clear. Under the 12 years of the Republican Governor Pataki, we spend plenty. And one of the things we spent a lot of money on was tax cuts for people who did not need it. When you cut taxes for people who don't need tax cuts, you're spending money, in essence. You're depriving yourself of income. And that did not help anybody, as far as I could see. You know, there was talk a few years ago, if we added an income tax surcharge for millionaires, that it would drive millionaires out of the state. Well, when we lowered taxes for millionaires didn't come flocking to the state. The fact is, people are in New York, especially in New York City, because they want to be here. Now, the question is it cost-effective for us to spend money on things like education? And I would suggest that the answer is yes. And we're not talking about a massive tax increase for rich people. We're talking about a relatively small income tax surcharge
less
on
than
people.
1%, yeah.
It's a relatively tiny amount, mm-hmm. and if the result is that kids can get into educational programs at an earlier age, and we know that every single study shows that if kids start school at an earlier age, they're much more likely to succeed. That's good for everybody, including wealthy people.
Well, the mayor did say today that he's looking for a 5-year tax, and then once that's done, he's hoping it will fund it, and then it can, I guess, morph into the general budget.
I think the reason why his proposal makes sense is because it would be a form of income for the state, revenue for the state that we don't have to keep going back for the next 4 years. If there's money put in for universal pre-K in some other fashion, perhaps, which is what some people think could happen, it might mean that we're going to have to fight for it next year and the year after. We shouldn't have to fight to educate kids. That should be something everybody, liberal and conservative, should want to do.
A conversation that the three of us had just before we went on the air, I'll clue you into it, was about this idea of a pork barrel spending, of a member item spending. And this, of course, every time there's allegation of corruption, that somebody has misappropriated some of their member items, then the whole system gets looked at. The governor has been very strong about ethics reform. Is that on the right track? And should we look at member items and say, you know what, maybe there's another way of handling this?
Yeah, but can I just go back to the universal pre-K money? You know, if there's one thing that really happened today that's positive, and that is that both the governor and the mayor agree philosophically that funding should go to provide universal pre-K opportunities for young
regardless
kids.
Of where it
regardless
comes from.
Of where it came from. Now, the governor was talking about a surplus, a budget surplus, and the mayor's talking about an outright, less than 1% tax for people making over $500,000. But philosophically, both agree that we should have universal pre-K, that there should be after-school programs in all the intermediate schools. And I think that's a good thing. And so there won't be a conflict on the program itself, mm-hmm. It will be more a discussion on where we're going to get the funding on. On the member item money,
yes.
I think that there should be some form of fairness in budgeting, if anything, so that small groups, the little leagues that the assembly member talked about earlier on in the conversation, the smaller groups that live on a shoestring budget, mm-hmm. that they should have the opportunity to get some resources from the state.
Should there be restrictions on legislators and either their control over
yes,
setting
absolutely.
Up
a non- no question about
well,
it.
Well, there should be restrictions. Yeah. If there's restrictions on legislators, there should be restriction on executives. Why is it assumed that the executive branch, whether it's a governor or a mayor, is more capable of determining what my community needs than I am capable of doing? The money that we get from member items that we have gotten in the past, they fund local community organizations. The grants go to groups like the Marshall Lamont for a Community Center or the Riverdale Mental Health Association and so on. These are important organizations that serve constituents, usually constituents who are not that well off, at least in most cases. Mm-hmm. And because there were a few rotten apples like a Pedro Espada, like a Larry Seabrook, people who've been convicted and have gone to jail, that doesn't mean that every community has to suffer because of a couple of people. So there are member items now, except the governor controls it. He's distributing money through these regional economic councils. And I'm not saying they're doing a bad job. I'm just saying it's not like the money's disappeared. It's being used, it's being controlled by somebody else, and it's being used for different purposes. But our local neighborhood groups in Riverdale and Kingsbridge and Norwood, Woodlawn and so on, they're suffering as a result of it.
Changing gears slightly, and I want to get back to the idea of ethics reform. One of the things that's out there is stricter use of campaign contributions. Is this going to help? Is this going to at least send a message that the people of the state of New York are not happy with the dealing that goes on in elections and otherwise?
All those things are good. I certainly support all the ethics reform proposals that are out there. But the truth is, somebody who's a crook is going to find a way to be a crook. And restricting how everybody else has to live is not necessarily going to stop the crook from being a crook. And we should not delude ourselves into thinking that because we have to report more details about our income and mm-hmm. so on, that somebody who's stealing money is going to suddenly, oh, I got to report my stolen money because we have a new ethics reform. That's probably not going to happen.
Probably not.
I think that the state should go to campaign finance reform.
Much like New York City
much
has,
like
with
New York
matching
City.
Funds.
Matching funds, you know, it lowers the cap. It allows other folks to participate in the electoral process. It allows people to run against me and the assembly member. You know, this is fairness, and it's worked for New York City. I think that that's the way to go. I think it should be national, actually, that mm-hmm. the campaign finance reform should be national. We should take, you know, big money out of politics, you know, and you know, unfortunately, you know, the Supreme Court in the Citizens United case yep. allowed, you know, for an unprecedented, you know, decision that allows for huge money to come into politics unaccounted for, you know, anonymously. And so, you know, that corrodes at the confidence of people having government. I think that there should be a campaign finance reform, and it should be across the board.
I think my reaction to that would be similar to what my reaction was at the beginning. Let's start with New York State, and then we can worry about the rest
That's
of the
great.
Country.
Yes. Well,
Bob from Riverdale, our good friend who likes to call in. How are you, Bob?
Good evening, the legislators.
How are you?
It seems like I was just with Assemblyman Dinowitz about 15 minutes ago.
Really? So you gave him all the tips on what he should say when he comes
it's
in?
It's kind of like a recurring nightmare.
Yes, I agree with you.
Two different perspectives. Yes.
Since you're talking about education,
right?
Please, both of you, would you give me your opinion of the new chancellor, Carmen Farina?
Okay.
Because Mayor de Blasio wants tax hikes. Now, do you think also that she should be able to wind up earning her regular salary as chancellor, which is about $225,000, and her pension, which is almost $200,000, which puts her at an annual salary of about $400,000 she'll be earning.
Okay. I will ask the question. I mean, to me, and I'm going to answer the second part of it, I mean, she earned the pension over years. Right. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. I mean, people can evaluate what they think, but, I mean, that's the salary for the chancellor.
I think she earned a $100,000 pension.
Well, she did, but right,
she
I mean,
did, you know,
go ahead, you can
She's
respond.
A real pro. She's been in there in the trenches. She's an educator at heart, and you know, her resume is just impressive. And I think she understands the classroom. She has, as other previous chancellors, has placed special interest and emphasis mm-hmm. on intermediate schools. I think she's a real pro. People won't be able to draw circles around her. You know, not the teachers' union, not the teachers, not the parents, not the bureaucrats. I think she's going to be a real fresh breath air, a good breath air in the system.
What do you want to see from her?
You know,
what would you like to see happen in the schools in your district?
First of all, stability, right? I believe that during the Bloomberg days, we had restructuring going on back and forth. For a very yep. long time, restructuring was going on back and forth, and teachers and administrators and parents didn't know what was going on. I think she needs to bring stability first to the school system. I think that she's very innovative, and I think that there needs to be some innovative and creative ideas that will shake the system up a bit mm-hmm. and bring it back to where it should be. Intermediate schools is a good way to start because
that's what she said she was going to do. Yeah.
The chronic problems are there at that level. That's where we very often lose kids. But also universal pre-K is an excellent opportunity to give kids a head start. The program stays it.
What would you like to see from the chancellor?
First, I'm pleased that she was chosen. She has a great reputation, a lot of experience. She's an educator, which is a departure from the Bloomberg years. I appreciate the fact that she seems interested in ending the favoritism that the DOE has shown towards charter schools. I'm not saying discriminate against charter schools, but they were given favorite status in the Bloomberg administration. I think that she's going to shake things up, and I think the senator is right. We kept going from one form of governments to another, back and forth. The city was so focused on the structure, but not focused on actually educating kids. And having an educator in there, I think, will make a difference. And as far as the pension, it is a lot of money, but you know what? The rules are the rules, and if we don't think somebody should be able to do that, then change the rules. But she should not be criticized for taking that to which she's entitled under the law.
I want to go back to the campaign notion, and Assemblyman, you've been behind some of the effort to have primary day move so that the primary days are on the same day. Explain to viewers what this is and why you're advocating for that.
In summary, for the past 40 years or so, the primary elections were held in September. Due to a law passed by Senator Schumer on the federal level to make sure that military voters can get their absentee ballots in a timely fashion, it was determined that the primary elections had to be pushed up in order to expand the time between primary and general election. So the primary elections in New York cannot be later. For federal elections like President, U.S. Senate, and Congress, can't be later than sometime in the middle of August. The court ruled this year that the federal primary, which means for House of Representatives, will be on June 24th. Now, and you may disagree for possible particular reasons. It seems to me that having two separate primaries is just bad for a few reasons. One is it will cost the state taxpayers $50 million extra to run two primaries as opposed to one. That's just crazy to flush $50 million.
Doesn't give voters enough time to really find out who the candidates are and campaign into a primary for the state primary, which has been held in
September. They got plenty of time. Most voters don't focus on elections until very close to the election. That's just a reality.
So you're saying it wouldn't matter if it's, you know, August 15th or September 1st?
Well, I don't know. I don't think it should be in the middle of the summer.
I meant that when they begin to focus.
It's hard enough getting people out to vote in one primary. Having two primaries is going to depress turnout. Having all the primaries on the same day for the various offices, which is what we've done forever, makes more sense, and it'll save us $50
million. What do you think, Senator?
Whether you have separate primaries, one in September and one in June, or both of them on the same date, and I will be willing to live with both scenarios. I don't think that's the center of the problem. I think the Board of Elections is the problem. And the fact that they have not been able to handle one election in a very efficient, in a very reliable way. And that erodes the confidence from the voters. And I think that we need to reform dramatically the Board of Elections.
The whole system.
I think that we should vote, we should have extended day voting as they do in other states. Mm-hmm. I think people should be able to vote for 3-4 days. And let people come out.
As long as there's different people voting.
We don't want people voting four times.
Yes. You know. Senator, the burning under question is, you know, would you challenge Congressman Rangel again? Are we too early to ask that?
This is a little bit too early, but I will be making up my mind relatively soon, and Jeff will be the first to know.
Guarantee
that.
You can come back to Bronx.
I love being the first to know.
Speaking of races, on the same day the governor will do his State of the State, the city council is going to vote for a speaker, and it's been a highly contentious campaign, if you will, to this point. How risky is the stance the Bronx Council delegation taking in the race for speaker? Because at least of the way it was reported, in fact, I just saw it in the Daily News on one of the blogs, that they had a meeting with the mayor, and literally the entire delegation stood fast and would not concede any votes other than Richie Torres to Melissa Mark-Viverito.
Look, I'm supportive of Melissa Mark-Viverito as our next speaker, but I think that the Bronx delegation and the county organization has taken a principled stand, and they stand by it. And, you know, I'm not in a position to question them. You know, it would be very easy for anyone to say, to fold, or to say, well, you know, I'm flipping on this because I may get a good chairmanship or something like that. But I think they stood their ground. I'm a supporter of Melissa Mark-Viverito. I think she's going to be the next speaker. I think she's going to be a wonderful speaker. But, you know, I respect the position that the county organization and the delegation has taken.
Although, of course, if she does become the speaker, taking that stance could mean not having chairmanships. What's your thought?
Well, number one, I would not. I don't take a stand on who the speaker of the council should be. If in the future, if our speaker ever retires at some point, I will take a stand on who the assembly speaker should be. As far as the Bronx delegation, I think it's very important that the Bronx delegation act as a delegation. I would hope that whoever the speaker is that they would want to be supportive of the needs of every community and every borough in the city, regardless of whether the council member supported them or not. If it turns out that the Bronx supports or doesn't support the person who gets elected speaker, and that speaker then deprives the Bronx, the poorest borough, of any kind of services, that would be a disgrace. And I can't imagine anybody would do something so horrible as that. Mm-hmm. I think the council will come together on Wednesday. They'll pick a speaker, and then everybody will unite behind whoever that speaker is and get down to business.
Should the mayor be as involved as he is? You can just answer quickly.
I don't think the mayor should be involved in the legislative branch anymore than I think the governor should be involved in picking the leaders of either house of the assembly.
That's a safe answer. Your thought is
similar. You know, I think there should be separate powers, but it would be naive to think that the mayor would not like to have someone that's philosophically aligned with him.
Assemblyman, I have to ask you, because both of us have, and I'm going to, there's no secret to the viewers, I've been very involved in the fight against the water filtration plant that has been built in the Bronx, and we have been on the same side of that issue for a long time. There were allegations at the last meeting that there is no fire alarm system installed in that facility. They say now that, you know, there will be one installed. How big an issue is that? Is that something that makes you say, aha, now we know, or where do you put that?
I think it's an important issue, but unfortunately, because there have been so many issues, so, you know, the cost overruns, the lack of jobs, the parks money not being spent, I mean, it's been one thing after another. It's almost like you become numb after a while. This project, in my opinion, has been the biggest scandal since the Tweed Courthouse was built back in the 18th century. And unfortunately, the previous mayor never saw fit to address this. And he had three multi-billion dollar scandals in his administration, the water filtration plant, City Time, and 911. And for whatever reason, the other two were at least focused on by the media, but not this. Perhaps because it's in the Bronx. I don't know.
We'd like not to think that was the case.
But that's the reality. Much of the mainstream media is allergic to coming up.
Do you think
the new
mayor will take a new look at this?
I hope he does. I mean, we can't stop the plant is built already, but I would hope that at least we can learn from our mistakes and get history correct. People should know the billions of dollars that were misspent on this project.
Senator Adriano Espaillat, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Great to be in the Bronx.
Yes, it was his first formal visit to the show. We had you on for a debate.
I was in Riverdale for 2 years. He never allowed me to come on this program.
He had the good fortune to represent part of the Bronx at least for a couple of years.
Assemblyman, thank you for coming back. And folks, if you have further comments or questions on anything you heard on tonight's show or anything going on in the Bronx, then email them to us at bronxtalk@hotmail.com or post them on our Facebook page, and we'll them on the air during a future edition of our program. You can be a fan of Bronx Talk on Facebook, and you can see our archives at bronxnet.org. You check out the Bronx Talk link, which is on the bottom right-hand navigation bar. Next week, we will tackle the proposal to build a soccer stadium in the Bronx. And then on Martin Luther King Day, January 20th, a show about Each One, Teach One, mentoring in the Bronx. Bronx Talk is Monday nights at 9. Thanks to our producer, Jane Folloro, director Shirley Arrieta, studio coordinator is Dina Valentin. We'll see you next week. Good night.
I grew up in the housing projects of Cleveland. I didn't even know that life could be any better than it was. Education for me has been a way to get away from the agony of what was normal life. I want to be able to impact the community, not just look back on where I came from, but to reach back to where I came from and pull some people up with me. My name is David, and I am your dividend.